And I think I'm going to go to the Eniton story now. So the Eniton story is a non-profit organization in Spring Lake Park, Minnesota. And the mission of the organization is to advocate for victims and empower survivors of human trafficking and domestic violence. Especially in the immigrant community, what we find out first might be domestic violence. But, excuse me, when you start digging further, then we start finding elements of human trafficking. And next month is Sexual Assault Prevention Month. Also, I would like to add that most of the time too, survivors of human trafficking are also sexual assault victims. Because when you are under somebody's control, the person can do whatever he or she likes with you. And you know, in prison show now is what we're using to promote any story work for the community to see. And then we also do referrals. So for example, we refer to different organizations in the community. We have a woman actually from here in Brooklyn Park that we were helping from, it's going to 2 years now, how time flies. I got a call, and that day I was just at the fabric store here in Brooklyn Park. And the call came from Robbinsdale, from a women's center there, asking for help for a woman. And it was because I had gone to that clinic to train their staff, and they're using my book as training material. So if you have an organization or you have a group, that book will help you to start understanding how to really help those people. Otherwise, we just keep saying we are helping when many get left behind. The help we are doing is not effective if most of the time some of those people that we're supposed to help are being left behind. And the lady was referring to us. We could do some of the help, and some of it, because we don't do legal services, we had to refer, and that's one of the things in the immigrant community. They most of the time need legal services. And we referred her for help, and she got help, and things are going great. And that's the person actually there. Those are our hands, because we kept working with her. So, like, and for those of you who have organizations, you do know that sometimes you help somebody, but the help continues. And she enrolled for the Survival Empowerment Sewing Program, and those two toes and the little paws were what she made within 6 weeks, going to class only once a week for 3 hours. And she made the bags and sold, and we gave her the money, because usually the goal is to empower survivors. So they're not doing that to make money for our organization. They're doing it to be able to empower them economically, because if you ask sometimes for domestic abuse, thank you so much. One of the things you hear is economic hardship. So how do you help someone to continue such that they don't get re-exploited? Because, you know, survivors get re-exploited in so many different ways that, you know, I can't start counting here for you. And then SASI is our new baby that we just launched by the Eniton Story. It's called Students Against Abuse and Slavery International. And the goal is to engage students around the world, specifically college students, in human trafficking awareness in order to prevent others from becoming victims of human trafficking. And you know, those pictures are, our board member was in that picture. Yeah, and these are members of the advisory council. Thank God I was able to get them of them here today. And to learn more about them and their bio, you can go to whitehouse.gov, because these are also leaders in their various communities. These people, some of them have organizations like Eniton Story to help other victims and survivors out there. And some of them are working with federal agencies and other non-profit organizations in their various communities. And our role as advisory council, we provide recommendations to the federal government, and we submit a report. In fact, our first report is due in May. So if you have an idea you would like to share with us, or if there is something in the law right now that you are not happy with and you want us to help with, please do reach out to the advisory council. The advisory council wants the ideas of survivors. And every member on the council is a survivor. And the council is diverse in the sense that there are youths on the council. So the youth population is represented. There are women, there are men, there is sex, there is labor on that council. There is child trafficking, there is adult trafficking. So it's not just one form of trafficking or only one group. And even though, you know, when we went for inauguration, because of course, as survivors, we don't polish what we say. And vetting that I was told not to tell nobody. It's good when you are being watched and you don't know that you are being watched. Trust me, it's not good. It's not a good place to be in. When you are being watched and you are told do not tell, but we are watching you. You know, when I'm driving and somebody is behind me for too long, I'm like, okay, so who is this person following me? Is this person telling me or what is going on? You know, but I'm grateful that I made it on there, and my goal is to really lend my voice and be able to help other survivors in the community. And, you know, we all bring expertise, like I said before, from our different experiences, because also our experiences were not experiences in the classroom. They are real life experience. And today I would like to ask you, as an organization, for those of you who have organizations here, when you hire somebody straight out of college, do you hire them just because of that degree, or there are other stuff added to read that the value that they have to bring to you? So also, even for an employer to hire somebody, they're still looking for those real experiences that that person can bring, not just the certificate. And in our case, we bring all these life experiences to the federal government to help with the work the federal government is doing to help survivors across the U.S. And like I said before too, that we represent diverse population and the community. And we give our report to the President's Task Force. And the task force is headed by the Secretary of State, John Kerry. So still part of our responsibilities, we look at, you know, what is available in the community. What are the federal agencies doing? Because there are about, I think, 11 or 12 federal agencies that happen to be on the President's Task Force. And we look at what they are doing and provide our own recommendation. And one of the things we were asked to do was to go out in the community and listen. You know, so now I'm standing in front of you, not just to talk to you, but also to listen to you. Do you? Because it's when we talk like this in the community or when we are talking with one another that a lot of things come up. Things that when we sit together might not necessarily come up. So things like this that come up, we need to bring it up there to them to see in order to start making the change that we really want to see to help survivors across the U.S. and other parts of the world. And we submit our report every year. So also our work, we help to shape services. So whatever services that are out there already, part of what our work we do is to look at those services and make recommendations. Because like I said before, it's one thing to provide services. It's another thing entirely to provide the services that meet the needs of the people that you are serving or the population that you want to help. Because we found out that many people get lost in the process. Many people do not get help in the process. Many people get some help and can't get some help. Even a part of the things we're hearing is some of the grant applications have some undertones and some language in it that do not allow certain organizations to apply for grants, like federal government grants. So what are those things that you are seeing in applying for grant that is not letting you get the grant to help the population? We want to hear about this because those people you are helping are people that we've been in their shoes. We've worked in their shoes. And the challenges we experience while we are getting services, we don't want them to experience the same challenges. We want everybody to be able to get help regardless of who they are, whether it's a woman, a girl, a boy, a man, or somebody from the LGBTQ community. And you can contact us, like I said. You can contact us right now. Our contact, if you want to reach the Advisory Council as a body, the contact is through the Department of State Trafficking in Persons Office. So if you go to them, they will contact you with the Advisory Council. And the council is open to questions and suggestions and discussions in the community. I said earlier that we have a report that is due in May. So if there's something you want us to include in that report for May so that we can get them started, please, because we haven't decided yet what is going to be in the report. However, we've been listening and we'll be collecting information. I was in Dallas 3 weeks ago, and part of what I did was to listen and collect information from Dallas, which I already submitted to the Advisory Council. So if there is something you want to be in our report for the federal government, please reach out to the Advisory Council. And you can contact me. I am Bukola Oriola, and I'm available for training, workshop, keynote, fundraising, you know. Any gathering that helps survivors out there, I will be available. And those are my contacts. And you can see, I didn't list all my social media contacts. I'm all over, you know, the internet. So thank you so much for your time and listening. God bless you. I'll be glad to take questions.